Good afternoon. I'm Lindsay Coates, president of Interaction. I'm very excited to be here with Philippe and Kristalina to talk about urgent issues for civil society with the World Bank at the spring meetings. I'm very gratified that they're very open to having a dialogue. I will encourage you to send in conversations via Twitter, Facebook, and YouTube, because we would really love to hear from you. But I'd like to start with an issue that we are very engaged with, all of us, regardless of where we sit in the international development space, and that is enough money for the SDGs. So maximizing financing for development is huge. We know that the need and the money are way far apart. Is there anything you'd like to share with us about what's happening in that space right now?
Well, we have a piece of great news. We just issued our first bond for the International Development Association. This is our fund for the poor countries. And what we managed to do is to mobilize $1.5 billion from the financial markets at a very low cost, using the reputation of the World Bank Group and the fact that markets know us to transfer money at a very, very low cost to poor countries. And just to say two things about this bond issuance. One, it was 4.6 times oversubscribed. Mm. People say, we want to invest in doing good in the world. Mm-hmm. So we had to actually ration the bond. And two, during the issuance, the price went down, down, down. And for a development professional to hear this click, 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 in the downward direction, that was a music to my ears. So what we want to do in the World Bank is to make sure that this huge liquidity that is out there in the hands of financial institutions, in private sector, that a big chunk of it goes and flows into the developing world, especially the countries that are left furthest behind.
That's really terrific news. And I think Philippe, I would be really interested to hear you talk about maximizing finance for development in a way that also observes the safeguards and the protections that civil society looks to the bank to uphold. Could you speak to that?
Well, on the MFD, MFD is an objective.
Huh? Right.
It's maximizing finance for development,
right,
as you said, because the gap is huge.
Right.
Four trillion needed, 139 billion available in ODA. Okay. That's so
right.
The gap is monstrous.
Right.
The only way, as Kristalina says, is how do you crowd in the private sector?
Right.
You could do it with bonds, but you can do it also at the project level.
Mm-hmm.
So when you have a project, you can decide, can we crowd in for this project instead of adding public debt on the books of governments, and we see public debt going up.
Right.
Can you crowd in the private sector to do that particular project?
Right.
To finance and, if possible, execute.
Right.
Because I was yesterday with the Minister of Finance of Jordan. He was telling me the problem we have when we finance publicly, we don't have the money to do the maintenance.
Right.
While if you do it with a private, you put in the contract, that's part of the deal.
Right.
And you don't put public debt. So that's the idea.
Right.
On the safeguard, I know where you.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
No, but we have to.
We care about the
context.
Safeguards.
Yeah, yeah, no, no. But
very,
you have to understand
important.
What is the concept.
Yeah.
The safeguard, if it is the World Bank and IFC, we have the safeguards.
Mm-hmm.
We have a long track record.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, sometimes we are told in IFC we're too slow because we want to make sure that we have our standards are upheld on governance, accounting, on environment.
Mm-hmm.
Social, and these are being tested again and again. So as long as this come with us involved, we can ensure you the standards will be totally the best standard there is. In fact, other people now, you know, the Equator Principles, and the private sector, private banks are trying to import some of these standards, which is a massive.
That's very interesting.
It's a massive achievement.
Why do you think that is? Do you think citizens care
exactly.
more about
their
these issues today?
Their shareholders. I think there's a new generation, both on the CEO sides.
Right.
And we were in Paris, even on climate change. Now you see more and more the private sector and CEO making big commitments.
Right.
But also their own shareholders. They want to make sure that there is responsible investing and responsible management of funds.
And also the world has changed. with social media comes natural transparency. Mm-hmm. Whatever is being done anywhere on this planet is for everybody to see.
Right.
And also, as organization, we have learned over many, many, many decades that when people's voices are heard, projects are done better, they meet the needs, the priorities of people. And when we empower communities, they supervise for us. They're there to make sure that the projects we finance do the job well. Yeah.
So I think all of this is really important, and I think people who care about the big picture find this really important. But I want to press you on the question of citizen engagement and citizen voice, because we're living in a world where there's increased skepticism of all kinds of institutions, and you're seeing some response in terms of what CEOs and others are doing. But what can civil society do to really increase the citizen engagement and citizen voice within, you know, your institutions to make them even more accountable? I know you're committed, but what else can we do, because we care?
Well, there are two things. Let me first say that I'm actually very proud coming out of the issues of the EIDA bond, of the bond I talked about, that the trust of people out there in our institution is actually quite high, and the subscription shows it. But how? And it is because we have been over time becoming more transparent, more responsible, more accountable. What can civil society do? Two things. One, relentless engagement.
Relentless. Keep, I like that.
Yes,
that's a great
keep
word.
Our
relentless
feet to the fire.
Yeah.
Do that. And two, when we engage in the way we measure performance. Give us your sounding board. Are we doing well enough? Is there something we don't see? And that has to be mutual accountability.
So you're talking about the feedback loop?
I talk about the feedback loop. I talk about the ability to capture the voice of people. And then we become a translator of this voice in the high corridors of power. But then expect from us to go back and account for what we have achieved.
Yeah, and I think that that relentless accountability piece is really important. I'm interested.
Can I add something
Yes, please do. Yeah.
On what we can do upstream also, especially in the private sector, because it's a bit different, because they have public institutions, and then they have the private sector. On the private sector, what it, and it's, I was surprised when I took over in IFC. In fact, we'll have during the spring meetings a session on women violence against women. It's amazing. Now the private sector is getting interested. Why? Because we work upstream with civil society to increase the awareness on the private sector of this problem. Same for childcare. We have the whole book that we did. So I think that engagement intellectually and awareness upstream is very powerful. Especially if you can translate that, that it is good in the end for the company. Violence against women, we estimated it's millions and millions of losses for the company. So you can translate that also in in dollars.
You know, it's interesting because the what you're speaking to also coincides with the questions we're getting from social media. One of them is the wanting to hear more about what the World Bank is doing to ensure inclusion of vulnerable groups like the disabled, to be sure that they're brought into these World Bank conversations. Because to be perfectly frank, for someone like me who represents a northern CSO, I'm here in Washington, I can get here. You know, I can get here, but I don't represent everybody, and I don't understand everybody's perspective. So what kinds of things are you all committed to doing?
What we have done, and we will do more and more and more, is to be there where people live, where problems are. We have been moving our staff to field offices, even in the most difficult circumstances. We are in Iraq, we are in Afghanistan, we are in Mali. And that presence allows us to be much better informed about everybody. But then very explicitly demand from ourselves to be exemplary in terms of inclusion. Inclusion of women, attention to children, mm-hmm. the space for the handicap, mm-hmm. and then we do what Philippe was describing. Mm-hmm. We are an organization able to translate this into what is in for me. Why mm-hmm. a government should care? Mm-hmm. What is the loss that occurs yeah. because women are excluded or handicapped people mm-hmm. are not part of society? Mm-hmm. And these numbers, they're big numbers. Yeah. They're very impactful.
Okay, that's good to hear, and I think that we really need to sort of keep that commitment to the grassroots inclusion up.
And also, when we walk the corridors mm-hmm. in our offices, mm-hmm. we ought to look like the world we serve, and yeah. we do.
Yeah, yeah.
Can interject on the pure handicap. I've been right. on crutches for nine right. months, so right. I feel extremely sensitive these days.
I noticed when I saw you. Yeah.
So I challenge my staff mm-hmm. to say, how do you mm-hmm. hire in the private sector someone right. that is blind, mm-hmm. someone that is on mm-hmm. a wheelchair?
Yeah.
And you know what? I'm starting to get some very interesting ideas from my staff on how to use new technologies mm-hmm. to be able to, who was someone that was not employable, becomes right. employable mm-hmm. for the blind, for the deaf, yeah. for the people in wheelchair, mm-hmm. and what type of job. So we're starting to do a lot mm-hmm. of work on that. And it's quite interesting and more powerful than I thought, to be honest.
Ah, and you know, very interesting, we started initially with policies mm-hmm. That are like compliance policies.
Yeah. Right,
we
right.
hold you to account
right,
to do
right.
it. And now it more and more translates into good development.
Mm-hmm.
We do it because it is the right thing to do
yeah.
for development.
Right, and I think that's what is going to make it sustainable yeah. over the long run.
Can I share, can I share just okay. one thing? When I took the job, I went to visit all clients of mm-hmm. IFC. And I asked them, and some of them were started with nothing, mm-hmm. a little SME. Now mm-hmm. they're a multi-billion mm-hmm. enterprise. And I asked them, what did we bring to you, we mm-hmm. IFC?
Right.
What did we bring to
right.
your company?
Right.
And to be honest, mm-hmm. my expectation was, oh, you brought me the first million, and that yeah. Since yeah. then it was his story. Mm-hmm. They say, you forced me to do the standards correctly, mm-hmm. environment, social. And that
That's
because of that, I was able to go beyond mm-hmm. a small scale to medium scale to large mm-hmm. scale. Otherwise, I would not have been able to grow up. So you see this yeah. link between do good, mm-hmm. but it's good for you.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's critical. Otherwise,
yeah.
you can talk, you
yeah.
don't convince people.
Yeah.
And that for me was one of the best moments mm-hmm. in talking to our clients.
Yeah. So what
really
is your
good.
Other question?
So other question I've got is, and I am not an expert on environmental issues. So Philippe, how has the IFC been incorporating shadow carbon principles into its project analysis so far? And I think that we really haven't talked that much about climate, which is another mm-hmm. pressing yeah. issue.
Well, first of all, on climate, I mean, we have been ramping up very, very quickly. Mm-hmm. I mean, the latest number I see is 29% mm-hmm. of our new commitments. Mm-hmm. Huge in 10 mm-hmm. years from mm-hmm. zero to this is big.
Not from zero, but from low.
From very low.
And actually, so, we do it across the group, the shadow carbon mm-hmm. Pricing in all our projects now, in IFC, mm-hmm. in the World Bank. Mm-hmm. We would calculate a mm-hmm. shadow price for carbon. And on that basis, we will augment the mm-hmm. economic and financial analysis of a project. So a project that may look on face value great,
right.
when you pump up
yeah.
this
mm-hmm.
shadow price of carbon
right.
and you say, oh, wait a minute, we shouldn't do this sucker, and they're out.
We have
so
a
Philippe,
pilot.
is that
yes.
actually really baked into your decision making?
Yes, not today. We have just a pilot because there
okay.
are some technical issues
okay.
on how you compute
right.
it, how you compare
right.
between a project in agriculture mm-hmm. or
right.
financial sector, etc.
Right.
So we have a pilot, mm-hmm. and we plan next year mm-hmm. to kind of generalize it across
right.
the board.
Right. Mm-hmm. Well, I will have to say that as a U.S. citizen, I think the multilateral agencies' leadership in this space is really, really important.
Yeah.
Really, really important. And I encourage my colleagues out there in Facebook land to sort of, you know, encourage you on this
yeah.
topic, because I think it's really critical. I think one more thing that I'd be interested in hearing hearing more about, because most civil society groups are really interested in human development, development of the individual, human dignity, is I'm interested in hearing more about human capital and the human capital agenda, because you've been very pragmatic in your conversation so far about good for the country, good for people, good for the institution. How does the human capital agenda fit?
It actually started from the following. For the first time last year, we calculated the share of human capital in the wealth of nations. And to our surprise, we found out that 2/3 of the wealth of this planet are us, people. And richer countries are those that have invested in skills, education, earning potential, productivity, health, social protection of their people. And poorer countries are poor not only because their institutions are maybe not functioning, and that is a reason, but also because they have not done that investment at par.
Right.
So what we are now starting in the World Bank, we call it the Human Capital Project. It is to measure and compare countries by how they create skills and capabilities of people, make sure people are healthy, and that they are productively engaged in the economy. And where I see the private sector arm is critical is if you have skillful people but no jobs for them, well, you have capital that is idle.
Well, you have the Arab Spring too, honestly. I mean, you have really bad, really challenging things that, really bad things that happen. So one sort of final opportunity for each of you, what do you see as the role of civil society in the institution? What do we need to be doing as your critics, but as your partners, to really sort of achieve the SDG agenda and build a more safer, sustainable world?
Well, there's, as Kristalina was saying, I mean, and I completely agree, there's two sides of the coin, as you said. First is keep us honest, very important. And that is working extremely well, I can reassure you.
Great. Yeah. Glad to hear it. But we'll keep it up.
But I'd like to go a little bit further and also work with us upstream.
Right.
Because everything starts with ideas.
So what do you mean when you say work with us upstream?
What I was saying is we worked on, for example, this child care.
Right.
We did work with NGOs because they felt that it was a big issue.
Right.
We worked with them. Mm-hmm. We produced a paper that now it's becoming more and more the norm in companies.
So shape the policy dialogue.
Shape.
Yeah, and it is
by partnering upstream, not only downstream, say, oh, but you know, this is.
We see civil society as the natural environment where we function. You are partners, you are voice of people who may not have been able to find an avenue. You direct that voice to us at the bank, but you're more than anything else, the litmus test, are we succeeding or not? Because if you are on our back, if you push us, then you believe then we are a force.
Yeah.
And then if you don't talk to us, we are irrelevant. Huh?
Yeah.
But not only a force, a force for good. And we are grateful. We may not always agree, as you know.
Right. We may not always agree.
But we always have this dialogue open, and we are committed to that.
That's great. That's really, really great. Well, I want to thank Philippe and Kristalina for their time with us today. I think it's been very stimulating. I know there are more questions than we've had the opportunity to get to. So, but I think you can tweet at them, you know, and reach out to them. Don't hesitate. Engage.
And we will tweet back.
Actually, she does tweet back. It's the truth. Thank you all so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.